Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. All my video lectures are mainly for educative purpose. In continuity of common fevers which you see in your everyday practice, today we'll be discussing on one of the another very interesting topic. That is dengue fever. You will see very frequently after the monsoon season, and it can be lethal. So if you are able to pick up in an early stage, or if you are able to diagnose the dengue case, and proper treatment can reduce the mortality as well as morbidity. So dengue fever can affect anyone, any human being, whether male or female, whether young or old, or even in an infants or a newborns also. It is mainly transmitted by mosquito, which we call Aedes aegypti, and this is also called tiger mosquito, because of the typical stripes which are present on the body of mosquito. We'll be discussing under different headings, same as usual: definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigations, differential diagnosis, treatment and complications. Dengue fever is an illness due to infection by a virus which belongs to a family called Flaviviridae, or we call dengue virus. And there are four different viruses which are there, which are responsible for dengue infection in human being. It is Dengue 1, Dengue 2, Dengue 3, Dengue 4. These are RNA group of virus. It is accounting for 5% of the fever in the person who are traveling in the area which are having very high incidence of dengue, particularly Caribbean areas, Southeast Asia, etc. We call tropical and subtropical countries. It is mainly transmitted by the bite from a mosquito, and this mosquito are infected by this dengue virus. The mosquito which are responsible for this is Aedes aegypti or Aedes albopictus, and this is also called tiger mosquito. Dengue fever is also called breakbone fever because it produces severe body ache and bone pains. So, because of the presence of these typical stripes, it is also described as tiger mosquito. In Africa, the word dengue means fever with hemorrhage. As hemorrhage is very common in dengue fever, this was given a name, dengue fever. Means fever which is associated with hemorrhage, or you can call hemorrhagic fevers, one of the name. It is caused by a virus transmitted by a bite of mosquito which belongs to Aedes family, we call Aedes aegypti. So this is that mosquito which bites. There are many different names for dengue fever, like breakbone fever, dengue fever, dengue shock syndrome, hemorrhagic fever, Thai hemorrhagic fever, Philippines hemorrhagic fever, then Singapore, West Nile, etc. These are all the name given by different areas, etc. But basic, the most common name which we utilize is dengue fever or breakbone fever. As far as the different stages are concerned, it is being divided into dengue fever, dengue with warning fever, warning signs, dengue with compensated shock, and dengue with hypotensive shock. These are the main four classification which are being utilized. Initially, it was being classified as undifferentiated fever, where person comes with typical clinical symptoms and signs of viral fever, and you are not sure or you are not suspecting dengue fever. That's why it was labeled as undifferentiated fever. And when you confirm that that is due to dengue virus by a laboratory test, then you label that as a classical dengue fever. And in that also, we use some words we call suspected, probable, confirmed. And then there is one more word which is called expanded dengue syndrome. Suspected case means whenever the person, we have got a few slides, so those slides I'll have a pause and then I'll skip. So very simple way, if the person has got classical features of viral fever, that is fever with headache, body ache, bone pains, and person is having, say, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and you are suspecting dengue fever, then we call that as suspected dengue fever, because person is in an area where there is an epidemic or endemic, or person is coming from tropical area or subtropical area. Now, if you demonstrate in that particular person by a laboratory test and IgG or IgM is positive, IgM is positive, IgG is positive, we'll label that as probable. And if you demonstrate presence of NS1 antigen by a quick test or by RT-PCR, you demonstrate presence of dengue virus in a blood or what we call in a serum, now you will label that as confirmed case of dengue fever. Now, depending upon the presence of clinical features, severity symptoms, etc., we classify them into dengue hemorrhagic fever, short form it is called DHF, or dengue shock syndrome, that is called as a DSS. But this shock syndrome is divided into two, that is with compensated shock and hypotensive shock. And when the person starts recovering, we call convalescent phase or we call recovery phase, and then person can have what is called as expanded dengue syndrome, in which person has got organomegaly. These are the words which are being utilized. So now this is a very good slide which tells you the entire clinical picture of a dengue fever. So there are three classical phases we call febrile phase, critical phase, and convalescent phase. But before we put them into these three phases, dengue viral infection can be asymptomatic or symptomatic. Meaning, person who are symptomatic will have fever and will have other clinical symptoms and signs. While in an asymptomatic, may not be noticing the fever, body ache, and other clinical signs. So they are labeled into asymptomatic. And symptomatic group of people is divided into three phases: febrile phase, critical phase, and convalescent phase. In a febrile phase, where you got a typical viral symptoms and signs, we put them into a group we called as undifferentiated fever. And if he has got a clinical symptoms and signs, and by laboratory picture, we demonstrate the presence of IgM or IgG, we call that as dengue fever. Now, this dengue fever with clinical symptoms, now normally undifferentiated and dengue fever clinical symptoms and signs are almost similar. That is headache, body ache, nausea, vomiting, bony pains, abdominal pain, etc. But when you demonstrate by laboratory parameter the presence of IgM or presence of IgM plus IgG or IgG, you will label that as dengue fever. And if this particular person does not have any clinical evidence or clinical symptoms and signs of bleeding, we call dengue without hemorrhage. Some person now presents with some of the symptoms like epistaxis, little rash with little petechial hemorrhages, or even subconjunctival bleeding. Then we put them as dengue fever with bleeding, with unusual bleeding. Now this particular group of people, when they develop a secondary infection or may progress to dengue hemorrhagic fever, or we call plasma leak. Now because of now leakage of plasma, the vascular fluid volume, that is blood volume, reduces, plasma concentration will take place, hematocrit will be affected, you will have a leakage of plasma into the extracellular fluid compartment, you might have ascites, pleural effusion, etc. And depending upon the effect on the plasma volume, or we call blood volume, person may present with shock stage or person may present with without shock stage. So it is called compensated shock or decompensated shock or dengue shock syndrome. And this both will be put under a group we call dengue hemorrhagic fever, which is due to plasma leakage and bleeding. So without shock, with shock, dengue shock syndrome. All these three, that is dengue hemorrhagic fever, which is divided into two, that is without shock and with shock, we put them into a group we call as a severe dengue. While a person who does not have a bleeding, where there is no bleeding, usually we call that as a dengue fever without bleeding. And as the person starts bleeding, he has got tendency to go towards severe dengue. Or you can call that severe dengue as dengue hemorrhagic fever. And that dengue hemorrhagic fever is divided into two groups, with compensated shock and person with a shock stage, dengue shock syndrome. Now from this, person may recover, we call convalescent phase or recovery phase. And person may recover completely, or person may go into what we call as expanded dengue syndrome. So this is an entire picture what you come across. Now for this, we call as case assessment, and you will have to put them into a four different groups by clinical history, by laboratory parameters, and that we call as case assessment, which is also helpful to put them into four groups, and it will help you to decide regarding line of treatment. So any person who comes to with fever and any one of two of the following, like nausea, vomiting, rash, body ache, pains, bony pains, etc., we'll call that as undifferentiated fever. Now if this particular person, if we demonstrate positive tourniquet test, where you tie a tourniquet or you use a BP cuff, elevate the pressure above the venous pressure, maintain it for few minutes, and if there is an appearance of a petechial hemorrhages in an area which are more than 15, we'll call that as positive tunicate test. And in a peripheral smear, if you demonstrate leukopenia and thrombocytopenia, you label that as dengue fever. Now, in this particular person, if you don't demonstrate positive tunicate test or leukopenia, we label that as undifferentiated fever. Now, with clinical picture like persistent vomiting, abdominal pain, lethargy, restlessness, sudden behavior changes, bleeding like epistaxis, black stool, hematemesis, excessive menstrual bleeding, hemoglobinuria or hematuria, giddiness, pallor, cold clammy extremities, decreased urine output for more than 4 to 6 hours or almost no urine output for 4 to 6 hours, which suggests hypotension and decreased perfusion of the kidney, liver is enlarged, and on a laboratory parameter, if hematocrit is increased by more than 20%, you will label these are all warning signs. And if these warning signs are present, we put them into a group, dengue fever with warning signs. Now, this particular person who has got a warning signs, you have to identify as early as possible whether dengue fever is associated with the hemorrhage or not. Then we put them into a group called as a dengue hemorrhagic fever. And with clinical picture of hypotension and shock stage, we put them into two different groups, compensated shock and hypotensive shock. So dengue with compensated shock and dengue with hemorrhagic shock or hypotensive shock. And by laboratory parameter, I already mentioned, suspected case means if the person who has got these clinical features with warning signs, you will put them into suspected group. And if IgG and IgM is positive, we'll put them as a probable. If NS1 is positive, we'll put them as confirmed or by RT-PCR test being positive. And in a recovery phase, if you get organomegaly, you will label that as expanded dengue syndrome. We'll be going through that in little more detail in clinical symptoms and signs. So already we call probable stage means nausea, vomiting, rash, aches, body pain, tunicate test is positive, and leukopenia. And if there is any warning signs with laboratory parameter of confirmed dengue case, which can be confirmed case, we'll label that by presence of antigen, or you demonstrate a dengue virus by a test. And that is either by NS1, which is a rapid test. If that is positive, we will call that as confirmed case, or by demonstration by RT-PCR of plasma. Then also you can label that as confirmed case. And now you look for all the warning signs. We already mentioned these warning signs. These are all the warning signs. And if the warning signs are present, now you look for the symptom signs of hemorrhage and you try to look for the symptom signs of shock stage. Then you divide them into, you use two words, we call severe dengue or we call that as dengue hemorrhagic fever, where there is a serum plasma leakage, severe hemorrhage, and there is a multi-organ failure. So this you will be able to identify by severe fall of blood pressure, fluid accumulation in a pleural cavity, in abdominal cavity like ascites and pleural effusion. Person has got severe bleeding, which can be demonstrable by epistaxis, hematemesis, bleeding per rectum, increased menstrual bleeding, etc. And organ involvement by elevated serum enzymes, which are SGPT rather than SGOT, or we call ALT elevation, which is more than 1000 unit. Person has got altered mental status, and even there is involvement of other organs like kidney, heart, etc. We'll put them into a group we call as a severe dengue, or you use the word dengue hemorrhagic fever, and depending upon the clinical signs of shock state, you will put as a with shock, without shock we call as a compensated shock. So usually we use the four criteria for demonstration of dengue hemorrhagic fever, that is fever with hemorrhagic manifestation and excessive capillary permeability in the form of pleural effusion, ascites, etc. and platelet count less than 1 lakh. Initial warning signs are disappearance of fever, drop in platelets and increase in hematocrit. This is a very, very important clinical clue which will tell you that person is heading towards dengue hemorrhagic fever. And if this particular person has got abdominal pain, persistent vomiting, abrupt change in the form of fever to a hypothermia, and there is an altered level of consciousness, etc., should give you a warning signs. And when the patient develops dengue shock syndrome within 3 to 6 days after the onset of symptoms, this is a warning sign. So we have got two groups, dengue hemorrhagic fever and we call hemorrhagic fever with shock. Hemorrhagic fever has got low platelet count. There are symptom signs of hemorrhage, and person has got a leaky capillary where you get pleural effusion and ascites. This may be two common things. And as far as laboratory parameter is concerned, platelet count is less than 1 lakh and you have got elevated hematocrit because of the leakage of plasma into a pleural cavity or into peritoneal cavity, and there is a hypoproteinemia and there is an elevated hematocrit by more than 20% from baselines. And if this particular symptom signs of dengue hemorrhagic fever is associated with narrow pulse pressure, that is less than 20 millimeter, cold clammy extremities, severe hypotension, there is a frank shock which requires resuscitation, and you got prolonged capillary refilling time, etc., you can demonstrate all clinical signs of shock stage, you will label that as dengue shock syndrome. So this is one very good slide which will give you the difference between compensated shock and decompensated, or we call hypotensive shock. There will be clear cut differentiation as far as level of consciousness is concerned. Person with compensated shock is still alert, conscious. While in case of a decompensated shock, there is altered level of consciousness in the form of restlessness, lethargy, stupor, etc. Capillary refilling time is little prolonged in a compensated shock, more than 2 seconds. While in case of a decompensated shock, capillary refilling time is markedly prolonged. And there will be mottled skin in the form of subcutaneous bleeding. You might have ecchymosis, etc. In a compensated shock, you will have a cold clammy extremities. While in a normal circulation, the person will have a warm and picking extremities. In a decompensated shock, they will be much more affected. It will be extremely cold and clammy. Peripheral pulse will be weak and thready in case of compensated, while it will be almost feeble or nearly absent peripheral pulse in the case of a decompensated shock, because there's a dramatic fall of a blood pressure. There will be tachycardia in case of a compensated shock, marginal elevation, while severe tachycardia with bradycardia in a late case of a shock stage will be classical in case of a decompensated shock. Systolic blood pressure may be slightly lower, but in an initial stage, systolic blood pressure is slightly elevated. Normal systolic blood pressure and diastolic pressure will be slightly elevated, and there may be postural hypotension, which will be demonstrable in a compensated shock. While in case of a decompensated shock, you will have a severe hypotension, and sometimes blood pressure may be not recordable also. The pulse pressure will start becoming narrow, and when it is less than 20, we put them into decompensated or hypotensive shock. But usually in a compensated, you will have a narrowing of the pulse pressure. Respiratory rate will be slightly elevated in a compensated, you will get tachypnea. While in a decompensated, you will have a tachypnea with hyperapnea, we call Kussmaul's breathing, and we label that as metabolic acidosis. Urine output will be slightly reduced in case of a compensated shock, but in a case of a decompensated shock, severe oliguria to a total anuria may be present. So this becomes a very useful slide. Clinically, almost we don't require any of the laboratory parameters in this particular to differentiate between compensated and decompensated shock. Very, very useful. So if you want to find out the difference in a severe shock syndrome between the two groups, compensated and decompensated, always use this particular criteria. There are certain other way of putting them into different grades. We call grade 1, grade 2, grade 3 and grade 4. And this has been classified by WHO. And this is a slide which tells you a pathological stage and what grade it comes to. So if the person who has got fever, there's a positive tunicate test, there's an increased vascular permeability, hepatomegaly, thrombocytopenia, you'll put them as a grade 1. Now, if this particular person has got hemorrhagic manifestation, hematocrit is rising, there's a hypoproteinemia, there's a leakage of plasma into a serous cavity like pleural effusion and ascites, and there are clinical signs of hypovolemia, you put them into a group we call as a grade 2. Now, if this particular person starts developing coagulopathy, symptom signs of DIC, then we put them into a group called grade 3. And now, once he starts developing a symptom signs of shock, severe bleeding, we put them into grade 4. So, we call as dengue fever with thrombocytopenia, positive tunicate test, grade 1. Grade 1 plus hemorrhagic manifestation in the form of epistaxis, hemoptysis, little bleeding, etc. But no signs of coagulopathy like DIC or symptom signs of shock, that is grade 2. Symptom signs of shock with coagulopathy, grade 3. Severe shock, grade 4. So putting together grade 1, general symptoms, body ache, myalgia, positive tunicate test, little petechia, grade 1. Spontaneous bleeding, grade 2. Spontaneous bleeding with capillary refilling time, prolonged. There's a little signs of hypotension. Capillary leak in the form of pleural effusion, ascites, etc., grade 3. And severe shock stage, grade 4. So this is WHO, which is divided into grade 1, 2, 3 and 4. Where clinical picture, we have called told you that dengue fever will be not into any particular group. But when you put dengue fever in grade 1, if all clinical symptom signs plus positive tunicate test and laboratory parameter by two things, thrombocytopenia less than 1 lakh and hematocrit rise by more than 20, it will be grade 1. Now, with this, if the person develops spontaneous bleeding, grade 2. If there is rapid pulse, means tachycardia, little low volume pulse, cold clammy extremities, capillary refilling time more than 3 seconds, and person is restless, is having a little altered level of consciousness, like restlessness, you can put them into grade 3. And if the person has got severe profound shock, means this is compensated shock. Grade 3 will be with compensated shock and grade 4 will be decompensated shock, or we call severe shock syndrome or severe dengue hemorrhagic fever. That is the way you classify. And we have already mentioned this, for a confirmed case, you require virus isolation either by RT-PCR or by NS1. And probable case where you are not able to demonstrate by RT-PCR or NS1, but there is a presence of IgG positive, and person might have IgG and IgM also positive. So when IgG is positive and it is raised 4 times the original level, then you will label that as probable case. So if IgM and IgG are positive, probable case. Where IgM is more favorable than IgG. And if you demonstrate RT-PCR positive or NS1 positive, we put them into a group called as a confirmed case. So this is suspected case, clinical picture wise, with thrombocytopenia and symptom signs. So you have to look for this. So this is by WHO, that following all must be present if you want to put them as a dengue fever. So suspected case where you don't have demonstration of NS1 or RT-PCR positive, then you label that as suspected. So you have got a clinical picture, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia and rising hematocrit. But if you have got along with this IgM and IgG are positive, you will put them as a probable group. And in a confirmed case, you demonstrate the presence of antigen by means of RT-PCR or by means of NS1 antigen, test positive. And when the person is recovering and you have got a isolated organopathy, particularly manifestation in the form of liver, kidney, brain, heart, then you label that as unusual manifestation or isolated organopathy or expanded dengue syndrome. This is during a recovery phase, and that was being labeled as expanded dengue syndrome. We have already mentioned regarding the etiology, it is by a flavivirus, and there are 4 serotypes, 1, 2, 3 and 4, and it is transmitted by Aedes albopictus and Aedes aegypti, and the mosquito is also called tiger mosquito because of the typical stripes which are present on the body. So there are 4 viruses. These are the shapes of viruses in a microscope. It is mainly a female mosquito, or very rarely by blood transfusion. An infected person donates the blood and that is given to a non-infected person, very, very rare, not common. Incubation period is around 4 days, we call 3 to 5 days. Viremia stage will last for 5 days. During viremia, if the mosquito bites, now mosquito has got dengue virus, and this mosquito, if he bites another human being, that human being will be infected by a dengue virus. This is how the dengue virus is transmitted from one human being to other human being, only by a mosquito bite, and that is by Aedes aegypti. And in mosquito, incubation period is 8 to 12 days. Virus resides inside the salivary gland of an infected mosquito, And then whenever there is a bite, it will transmit those particular mosquito to a human being. Now this particular has got two. One is in a mosquito and second is in an infected person. So we'll be going through that. So virus will be transmitted into the human with the mosquito bite by a mosquito saliva. Virus will localize and replicate in the various target organs, particularly lymph nodes and in the liver. And then from there, it will spread to the other lymphatic tissue and infected white cells. It will circulate in the blood, gives rise to classical clinical picture. And then whenever the mosquito bites to in this infected person in the stage of viremia, the mosquito will carry those particular virus again, and in a mosquito it will be replicating in the midgut, ovary, etc. And then it will be replicating in a salivary gland, and through the saliva during a bite it will be transmitted to the another human being. So a healthy person, there is an infected mosquito. Now this infected mosquito, if it bites the healthy human being, it will be transmitted. And usually this mosquito gets that virus from an infected person. So in a healthy individual, after the mosquito bite, incubation period is from 3 to 7 days. Mainly we say that 4 to 7 days. And dengue fever will not spread by a contact from one person to another person. It is all only by mosquito bites. So stage of viremia in a mosquito, we call extrinsic incubation period, can be right from 0 to 12 days, while intrinsic can be right from 12 days up to 28 days. We already told you it is a flavivirus. Mosquito is Aedes aegypti. And you require a nice environment, we call as a fresh water. So fresh water is the site where the mosquito will breed, and mosquito will bite during a daytime. So these are all the different sites where the fresh water is available, like your air coolers, pots, rubber tubes, tire tubes, tanks, septic tanks, then coconut, nutshells, etc. These are the sites where the breeding place is there for Aedes aegypti. And once this particular virus involves the lymph nodes, they multiply in the lymph nodes, they will alter the T cell immunology, and also the complement activation will take place, and you will have a decrease in the platelet count. Because of that, you can have a bleeding tendency like epistaxis, hemoptysis. These are called unusual bleeding. And you also, because of the immune modification, you have got a plasma leakage, and that plasma leakage will produce leak of plasma, hyperproteinemia, and that plasma leak will take place into a pleural cavity, ascites, etc. And because of decrease in the plasma volume, person can go into hypovolemic shock. This dengue virus usually replicates in a different cells, particularly we call lymphocytes and liver cells. And then they, after replication, it will mature and release into bloodstreams, and it will give rise to release of multiple chemical mediators like interferon, TNF-alpha, interleukins, etc., which will give rise to damage to endothelial cells and plasma leakage. And this plasma leakage will produce what we call as dengue shock syndrome, and because of associated with thrombocytopenia, the person will develop bleeding, and we call dengue hemorrhagic fever. So primary infections, T cells are selected. Secondary infections, now you have got cross reactions. You have got a cytochromes, cytokines release. It will produce cytokine storms. Then that will release TNF-alpha, interferons, interleukins, etc. And this will result into damage to the capillaries, and that will produce leakage, and that will give in the form of edema, plasma leakage. You can see this. And because of leakage of plasma into the serous cavity, the person can develop hypovolemic shock. Thrombocytopenia will lead to the bleeding tendency. So there is a loss of vascular integrity, increased adhesions molecules, increased cytokines production is the responsible factor for endothelial damage. So you have got platelet components are being affected. So you get thrombocytopenia, and also fibrinogen levels are being also affected. Immune mediated destruction of the platelet will produce thrombocytopenia, and anticoagulation via heparin sulfates, that is glycocalyx damage, will take place, and that will also lead to hemorrhage. So because of production of antibody, antigen-antibody interaction, complement activation, deposition on vessels, various tissue and platelets. So when platelets are affected, thrombocytopenia, vessels are affected, plasma leak, and other organs like liver, kidney, etc., you get multi-organ dysfunctions. And this can result into almost a picture, classical like DIC, we call manifestation because of coagulopathy. And because of activation of T cells, there's a production of various chemical mediators, and that will give rise to increased vascular permeability and dengue hemorrhagic fever. And secondary to dengue hemorrhagic fever, hypertension, shock, pleural effusion, ascites, bleeding, and multi-organ involvement. And that multi-organ involvement is because of the deposition of this antigen antibody, and that gives rise to multi-organ involvement. And mainly it is because of second infections, we call secondary infections, by again a dengue, another group of virus that is very, very common. So clinically we divide into four big groups: undifferentiated fever, classical dengue, and then when there are warning signs and symptom signs of hemorrhage, we put them into a group called dengue hemorrhagic fever. If it is without shock, usually we label that as a dengue hemorrhagic fever without shock. And when it is with shock, we call it the dengue shock syndrome or dengue hemorrhagic fever with shock stage. And these two are put as severe dengue. In a recovery phase, we come across what we call as complete recovery, or there may be organ involvement, and you got an organ megaly. We call expanded dengue syndrome. We already discussed this slide, so I'm not going into detail again, that you got a clinical picture which is undifferentiated fever, and with that, if you get a positive tunicate test, leukopenia with warning signs, you will label that as dengue fever. So in absence of warning signs, if you got only fever, little nausea, vomiting, rash, body aches and pains, you call undifferentiated fever. But if you got a positive tunicate test, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and person is having elevation of hematocrit, we will label that as dengue fever with warning signs. Now if this person gets developed during that warning signs, person might have a mucosal bleed, in the form of epistaxis, hemoptysis, etc. But now if we get symptom signs of compensated shock, you will label that as dengue fever or dengue hemorrhagic fever with compensated shock. And when there is severe symptom signs of hypotensive shock, I've already discussed one slide, you will label that as dengue hemorrhagic fever with hypotensive shock or dengue shock syndrome. And then person goes into a recovery phase. But during this particular labeling as a dengue fever, depending upon the clinical picture, you call that as suspected. Presence of laboratory parameters in the form of IgG and IgM positive, we call probable case. But NS1 is negative and RT-PCR is negative. And if those are positive, we call that as a confirmed case. We already discussed this slide. These are all the warning signs. This slide we already discussed before. So I'm skipping this slide. These are all warning signs we already mentioned. Intermediate medical attention, immediate medical attention should be paid if there are warning signs. Abdominal pain, persistent vomiting, red spots, patches over the skin, we call mottled skin, bleeding from nose, that is epistaxis, bleeding from gums, hemoptysis, hematemesis, black talus stool. Person has got altered level of consciousness in form of the drowsiness or irritability, cold clammy extremities, pallor, tachypnea, tachycardia, etc. This should be a wake-up call. You must wake up and pay attention to this warning sign and try to identify whether he belongs to a severe dengue or it is dengue with warning sign. And in a severe dengue, again, we divide into two: compensated shock, decompensated, or we call dengue with shock syndrome. Dengue shock syndrome. So that you should be able to identify. And this slide also I have discussed, so I'm skipping over. Asymptomatic, symptomatic, undifferentiated dengue fever, which you can divide into without bleeding, with bleeding. And then person goes into a critical phase. And in a critical phase, person can have a dengue hemorrhagic fever without shock and with shock, we call dengue shock syndrome. Both of these will be belonging to what we call the severe dengue. And then person goes into a recovery phase, or we call convalescent phase. And if person has got still persistence of organ involvement and organomegaly, we call as expanded dengue syndrome. So simple early signs, incubation period is 3 to 14 days. You divide into three phases: febrile phase, critical phase, convalescent phase. Febrile phase, we can divide into two. We already mentioned undifferentiated and suspected case, probable case, and confirmed case of dengue fever. Now, if this particular person starts developing some symptoms, we call warning signs, like tunicate test positive, thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, epistaxis, bleeding from gums, person starts developing hematemesis, bleeding per rectum, etc. Now we'll put them into a group we call as a critical phase. Now in this critical phase, we call with unusual bleeding and with plasma leak. With unusual bleeding, still we don't put them into a severe dengue. Once the person starts developing plasma leak like pleural effusion, ascites, massive bleeding, tachycardia, tachypnea, altered level of consciousness and hematocrit becoming more than 20, now we'll put them into a severe group. And in severe group, now we have to divide into compensated shock and severe shock syndrome. So these are all the things what are being given: febrile phase, critical, plasma leak, and convalescent phase. This is in combined picture of entire dengue fever. But what happens in fever phase, or we call febrile phase, what happens in a critical or plasma leak phase, and what happens in a convalescent period or reabsorption stage, at leisure time I've already discussed. So at leisure time you can go through. So this is a nice slide. So we have got three main phase: febrile, critical, and convalescent phase. And that convalescent phase is also called reabsorption phase. And critical phase is called as a plasma leak stage. And this is what is happening. This is a pathophysiology, what is being happening, and what will be the clinical picture. So it is combined together. So usually dengue fever, human gets infected. That can become inapparent. 30% will have an inapparent. 60% will go into dengue hemorrhagic fever. And only 1%, 69%, almost 70% we call. And only 1% will go into what we call the severe shock syndrome. Not common. Now, this dengue hemorrhagic fever, almost 100% recovers completely. From this dengue shock syndrome, 95% will recover. And 5% will go into what we call as a mortality, we call death. Dengue hemorrhagic fever, now if we get secondary infection, may go into secondary dengue hemorrhagic fever because of antigen antibody formation. So 10% of the people of dengue fever will manifest, we call dengue fever without hemorrhage, will manifest as dengue hemorrhagic fever or dengue shock syndrome. And this will happen because of reinfection. So human infections, and if he gets reinfected, he can go into what we call as dengue fever, and that can again go into secondary dengue hemorrhagic fever. This is what is a natural history of dengue. So do remember, a person, first time when he gets, we call first infection, when he gets reinfection, it can go into dengue fever with manifestation. And that person can go back to secondary stage because of reinfection. Or human first infection can also go directly into what we call as a very bad sign, that is primary dengue hemorrhagic fever. This is not so common, it is only 1%. While here, this is almost in 10% of the people who gets dengue hemorrhagic shock syndrome because of reinfection. So reinfection is having a high chance of going into dengue shock syndrome. So in a febrile phase, fever, headache, retroorbital pain, myalgia, arthralgia, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain are quite common. And usually, it will last for 3 to 7 days. And good number of time, we already shown you that almost 30% may not have much amount of symptoms. 70% of this will have those symptoms. Of that, almost 100% recovery is there. Only 10% of the people may go into secondary because of reinfection. So that will be one of the common presentation what we come across in our everyday practice. In a febrile phase, you will have lymphadenopathy, hepatomegaly, maculopapular rash, and as far as respiratory system is concerned, you can have a nasal congestion, sore throat, cough, etc. Good number of times this is misdiagnosed as upper respiratory tract infection. But if on a laboratory parameter you get leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and if liver enzymes are elevated, do keep it in mind, it can be dengue fever. So dengue fever will have a fever, headache, retroorbital pain, backache, myalgia, arthralgia, etc. These are the things which we call undifferentiated fever. And along with that, if you come across persistent vomiting and you have got leukopenia, laboratory parameter will be going through. Backache, vomiting, fever, body ache, vertigo, thirsty, etc. Insomnia, headache, tachycardia, cough, chest pain. And now you start getting, say, conjunctival hemorrhage, etc. You should suspect dengue fever. Dyspnea, eye pain, arthralgia, headache, abdominal pain, hematemesis. This will help you to identify dengue fever. So you will have a rash and you can see small hemorrhages. So if capillary refilling time is prolonged, again that will be in favor of dengue fever. If you do a tourniquet test, means you tie a BP cuff, elevate the pressure between systolic and diastolic and maintain it for 5 minutes. Now look at the spots, we call peticule spots. If there are more than 10, we call 15. More than 15 per square inch area, it is straightforward in favor of a dengue hemorrhagic fever. Usually we say that more than 20 will be 100%, but more than 15 will be also in favor of dengue fever. So tourniquet test becomes a very simple test. So positive tourniquet test, more than 20, definitely in favor. So you elevate the pressure between systolic and diastolic, maintain it for 5 minutes, look for the peticule hemorrhages, and if they are more than 20, straightforward in favor. Even if you don't use BP instrument, you can use this tourniquet and maintain it for 15 minutes. And if you look for the peticule hemorrhages, that is called positive tourniquet test. Now, once the person starts developing plasma leak, because this occurs in a small subset, most commonly because of secondary infection by another serotypes, then, and this can happen within 18 months of primary infections, usually occurs after defervations, 3 to 7 days, may last for 24 to 48 hours. There will be severe thrombocytopenia and person will have hematochezia, malina, hematemesis, epistaxis, female might have menorrhagia, etc. And because of vascular leak, shock and organ involvement, particularly AKI, liver involvement and CNS involvement, we label that as dengue shock syndrome. So in a dengue shock syndrome or dengue hemorrhagic fever, person will have a severe headache, dizziness, retroorbital pain, anorexia, abdominal pain, chest pain. You will have a tourniquet test positive, persistent vomiting, GI disturbances, rash, peticule hemorrhages, epistaxis, bleeding from gums, intestinal bleeding in the form of hematemesis, bleeding per rectum, malina. All these symptoms, whatever we have mentioned, will be present. You can see peticule hemorrhages, ecchymosis, peticule hemorrhages, purpura, hematemesis, epistaxis, bleeding from gums, bleeding from GI tract, and you got pleural effusion, ascites, etc. It will be straightforward in favor of plasma leak. And that plasma leak, if it is associated with hemorrhage, we call as dengue hemorrhagic fever. And depending upon the clinical status, compensated shock and severe shock syndrome. During recovery phase, there is a resolution of vascular permeability and hemorrhagic risk. Vital signs will stabilize now, blood pressure will come back, tachycardia will settle, tachypnea will settle. You might have an eruption of a new rash again, maybe pruritic. You have got reabsorption of plasma leak material. Person might complain of chronic fatigue for weeks, 2 months. That is very, very common. And usually you will have an improvement in general well-being, appearance of convalescent rash, hemodynamic stability, bradycardia in some patient, not common. Person may develop diuresis and now hematocrit will settle down. This will be all showing you that person is in a convalescent phase or a recovery phase. And you will have white cells, which was leukopenia, will start recovering and even platelet count will start rising. That is recovery phase. And during recovery phase, if person has got still persistence of organ involvement and organomegaly, we will label that as expanded dengue syndrome. We already mentioned viral isolation is the only method by which you can confirm the case, that is by RT-PCR or by rapid test NS1. By RT-PCR, you can also do a genome sequencing and you can identify whether it is type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4. And for antibody detection, in a rapid test, you can detect IgM, which will appear after 4th or 5th day. And after a week or so, you will have a demonstration of IgG. By and large, it comes positive. It will be definitely positive after 7 to 15 days. So if IgG and IgM both are positive, it will just tell you that person has got dengue fever, but probable. But if you demonstrate NS1, then it will tell you that person was infected. There is a presence of antigen. That will be confirmed case. And if these are negative, we'll call as undifferentiated fever. And if there is a demonstration of also SGOT and SGPT, particularly SGPT, within 3 days, will confirm the diagnosis. It is also one of the things which is being utilized. And as far as the blood count is concerned, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia, and rising hematocrit is in favor. So NS1, IgM, IgG, RT-PCR are the most important tests. SGPT is SGPT, or we call ALT, is important to find out the liver involvement. Thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, and rising hematocrit is also in favor. So IgG and IgM test, if the fever is 5 to 6 days old, and NS1 on the first or second day of fever, platelet will start reducing after 5 to 7 days of fever, and we call RT-PCR can be done at any time. So I'll just skip this slide. This is the slide which is showing you primary infection. What will happen in a secondary infection? You will have a very high level of IgG. In a primary, you will have little elevation of NS1 will be positive. IgM will start after 3 to 5 days. Then that will be converted into IgG. So IgM will be positive. It will start coming down and you will have appearance of IgG. And that IgG will persist for a long period. In a secondary, NS1 will also positive, but you might have by another genome, and IgM will be positive for a very short period, but you will have a very high level of IgG. So that will be helpful to identify primary infection and secondary infection. And this is that same slide showing you what will happen to laboratory parameters like hematocrit and platelet. In a recovery phase, platelet will start rising, hematocrit will start coming down. So hematocrit will start coming down and hematocrit will be normal. And you will be able to demonstrate NS1 during first 3 days much better. And then IgM and IgG will be positive. In a recovery phase, IgM and IgG will persist. And later on, only IgG will be positive. So this will be the important thing. So same thing is shown here. Late stage, you will have IgG because of primary infection, and secondary infection will also increase the level of IgG. IgM may be detected during that secondary infection also. RT-PCR will be positive in initial 3 to 4 days, and NS1 will be also positive for initial 3 to 4 days, maybe up to 5 to 6 days. Same thing is shown here. I can skip this slide. This is a positive tunicate test, very easily demonstrable. Now there is also one method which is called plaque reduction and neutralizing assay can be done. You can go for a viral cell culture, usually not required. There are other tests to find out the severity of the damage and severity of the case, like protein, sodium, calcium, then ABG. So that will be in a selective groups. You can go for coagulative profiles like prothrombin time, then you can go for urine, stool, x-ray chest, ultrasound for abdomen and pleural effusion. You should rule out malaria, typhoid fever, etc. So these are all the tests you can go through. We don't require everything in a, only few cases we require all this. But in a severe shock syndrome, you might require all this. Protein, sodium, calcium, then ABG, etc. And even coagulative profile. You must differentiate dengue fever from other hemorrhagic fever like Ebola, yellow fever, Congo virus, Henton virus, Lassa virus, etc. We call all hemorrhagic fever, other group of hemorrhagic fever. Now, after doing a good assessment, I've already discussed in detail regarding a good assessment. So after doing a good assessment, this is a slide. We have got the previous slides also. You should put them into a group, whether it is dengue negative or dengue positive. And if it is dengue positive, it is with warning signs or it is going for severe dengue. You should be. I will discuss all this. And then you put them into three groups. Group A, Group B, Group C. Group A means where you are having a suspected case, probable case, or say it is dengue positive, but there are not much amount of warning sign. So this particular group of people, you may send home. Group C criteria, patient who do not have a warning sign, but if this particular group of people starts developing any warning sign, you should pay attention. And depending upon that, now if the person is belonging to group B, we call with warning signs, then this is the treatment what should be done, and you should have a follow-up by CBC, hematocrit, etc. And in a group C, they definitely require an hospitalization, and you should follow up nicely and treat them seriously. So this is for the group A, adequate rest, adequate fluid intake, paracetamol, avoid steroids, avoid aspirin, and see that his hematocrit is stable, then you can send him home. If there is a warning signs, you have to hospitalize the person, observe, correct the fluid balance, then look at the clinical status, particularly by hematocrit, reassess the clinical status, and if the person has got compensated stage of shock, he might require a little amount of fluid. If patient improves, good. If patient does not improve, patient is still unstable, is heading towards what we call as a severe shock state, then you might require crystalloids. Then you can give that particular and proceed further. This is what you monitor. You can go through here at leisure time. What we say that fluid, rest, antipyretics, monitor blood pressure, hematocrit, platelet count, level of consciousness. In case of severe bleeding, you might require a whole blood. Usually, platelet-rich plasma may be given if the platelet count is very low, say 5,000 to 10,000. Yet, vaccine is not available. It is under trial. What you have to do is, you give colloids in a refractory shock. You can give a whole blood, or you can use platelet transfusion if the platelet count is tremendously low. What you should not do is don't give steroids. Give platelet transfusion for low platelet count. Just platelet count is say 1 lakh, don't give platelet transfusion. Hypotonic saline should be avoided. And assuming that all dengue patient needs IV fluid, don't just continue with IV fluids. This is CDC guidelines, which was published in 2019. This is all, I already discussed case assessment. Then you divide them into a different groups. Mainly treatment is supportive, paracetamol, avoid ibuprofen, aspirin, glucocorticoids. Dengue vaccine is under trial. In near future, we will have a free availability of a dengue vaccine, may be available. So supportive line of treatment, all what we have discussed should be done. There are other things what we call in the early stage, where we are observing, prevent dehydration by proper oral fluids. And if person is having persistent vomiting, then even IV fluids. Certain precaution, bed rest, take care of hyperpyrexia, avoid aspirin, avoid brufen, steroids, etc. Paracetamol is the only antipyretic which should be utilized. Oral fluids, then precaution against mosquito bites is we call prophylaxis. Dengue with warning signs, you will require to give IV fluids and hospitalize the patient. These are all the different indications of hospitalization, means indirectly we call dengue with warning signs, you must hospitalize. With compensated shock, after hospitalization, he might require you keep a watch on vital signs, and depending upon vital signs and laboratory parameters, particularly platelet count, hematocrit and organ involvement, your treatment will change. All are supportive line of treatments. This is hypotensive shock stage. You must follow these criteria. This is compensated shock. This is decompensated, or we call hypotensive shock stage. What you do? This is non-pharmacological treatment. We call bed rest, fluid intake, mosquito repellents, vector control, maintain hygiene, and patient education is a must. Prevention, particularly prevent the mosquito bite and prevent the breeding place of mosquito will be the main important things. So these are all the different ways in which you can prevent the mosquito bite to the human being. So try to take all precautions so that you don't have a mosquito bite. Until then, these are all the things what are being advised. Multiple different ways of advising. These are all multiple different ways of advising. 4S also, search and destroy, self-protection, seek early consultation, and say no to indiscriminate fogging. Also, these are all the different ways you try to control mosquito breeding. And also one of the way of mosquito breeding control is by a fish we call guppy fish. Then fumigations, different ways of fumigations, repellents, protection with mosquito nets, etc. These are all repellents. These are destroying the mosquitoes. You can use repellent and mosquito destroyers. Lamps are available, sprays are available, etc. These are all different types of lamps. These are all prevention of a mosquito bites. Among complications, hemorrhagic shock, encephalitis, encephalopathy, liver damage, seizures, DIC, transverse myelitis, very odd complication. Person can also present as GBS, and worst outcome, death. There are some odd complications we call acidosis, bleeding, hypocalcemia, hyponatremia, hypoglycemia. Neurological complications like seizures, encephalopathy, encephalitis, subdural effusion, mononeuropathy, GBS, polyneuropathy, transverse myelitis. These are atypical manifestations, but they are quite common in children. GI manifestation, renal, AKI, hemolytic uremic syndrome, cardiac conduction disturbances, myocarditis, pericarditis, ARS, ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome, hemorrhage, pulmonary hemorrhage, musculoskeletal complication, bone marrow complications like ITP, eye, miscellaneous. There are huge number of complications. Now there are newer approach what they are trying. They are preparing a mosquito and they are having a gene conversion so that majority of the Aedes aegypti cannot survive longer. This they are trying. Release of 3.3 million of Aedes aegypti resulting in a 80% reduction in the mosquito population. So they produce a gene mutation in Aedes aegypti. Those mosquitoes do not survive longer. So this is one way they are trying. There is another way, embryonic introduction of a strain so that that particular mosquito, Aedes aegypti mosquito, invades the natural aegypti population, suggesting that the possibility of induction of a widespread biological resistance to a dengue virus. So they are resistant to dengue virus. So you will have that particular strain. There is DenVax vaccine which is under trial, yet not marketed. There is also LATV vaccine which is available, tetravalent. So these are some of the vaccines which are under the trial. Live attenuated vaccine. It is as DenVax. Near future, it will be marketed. And it is by Sanofi. These are the different vaccines they are under trial. Phase 3 trial, phase 2 trials, etc. Now, there are different methods by which they are trying to find out the antiviral drugs. And there are some antiviral drugs they are under phase 1 trial, phase 2 trials, etc. So in near future, we might have also even antiviral drugs for treatment of dengue. So thank you very much for taking out time. I know that your time is valuable and I appreciate you for spending some of the time with me. I know that this topic is very, very important from clinical point of view because you will come across in your family, in your groups, in your friends, person is having dengue fever and they want your advice. If you understand this entire picture, you will be able to give them a proper advice and you can reduce the mortality. Sorry for an exhaustive lecture. If you like this particular lecture and if it is helpful to you, please press button like, subscribe and you can share with your friends also. So see you in next lecture.